This morning we're standing in front of one of the most iconic ecosystems on the Cape Peninsula, this kelp forest behind me. And I'm going to bring in one of my former PhD students, Yanis, who's working for the Sea Change Project. And we're going to talk about why the system is so important. So, you know, we're sitting here on the Cape Peninsula in front of this enormous kelp forest. Can you tell us a little bit about that kelp forest?
Yeah, so that kelp forest is this incredible three-dimensional underwater space, and it ranges from Namibia, all the west coast of South Africa, down around the tip of South Africa. And it's a place that we started calling the Great African Sea Forest a few years ago. That kelp forest has very important roles in the ecosystem, and it's a place that we realized that when we started with our work, people weren't, at least the general public, wasn't really appreciating this amazing kelp. A lot of people were like, what is this smelling stuff on the beaches, you know? Right. And I think over the years, through our work, but also through the work of many others, of course, this changed.
So, you know, don't these forests also operate a little bit like terrestrial forests, like an oak tree forest, for example, where you have an understory, you've got the trunks, and you've got the branches, and then the leaves above it. You've got these different layers and these different little niches.
Yeah, absolutely. It creates this three-dimensional complexity, and with complexity, it creates all these little spaces where very specialized animals and organisms can live in. And the more complexity there is, the more life, the more diversity, and it also the more resilient it makes this ecosystem to threats like global change and rising temperatures and all these sorts of things. So this forest really provides a lot of different functions to animals, but also to us as humans. Yes. So it's just
all the systems around it, isn't it, as well? I mean, it's not only things which are living in the kelp, but things on the beach, which...
Yes, it provides nutrients that kind of get washed up. Of course, when the kelp washed, like we're sitting here with all this kelp, it's being washed up onto these shores, and millions of animals benefit from this.
And animals out in the ocean as well. I mean, kelp particles are wearing off the kelp fronds. Planktonic animals out in the sea are actually eating those as well.
Yeah, so planktonic animals very, very micro, like some very small animals eats this kelp basically.
Yeah. So Yanis, I know you're doing a project at the moment on the kelp holdfasts. Can you tell us a little bit about what you've been finding there?
Yeah, so the holdfast, maybe to start, is basically the root-like structure that anchors the kelp to the ground. And it has all sorts of little roots that go to the side, and that creates a three-dimensional space where little animals can go in.
So it's a nice little sheltered habitat.
Yeah, it's a sheltered, very specific habitat that is very diverse and it's quite amazing, actually. And also, it's not just my project, it's a collaboration, and obviously you are helping us as well, but it's with a whole team of students and collaborators from Stellenbosch University, actually. We are actually overwhelmed by what's in there, because you look at what's in there and you're just finding so many different species. Like, there's all these bryozoans, there's nudibranchs, there's all these sponges that overgrow and grow into these spaces. And this year, with a student project this year, we're looking at only the little crustacea, so like little shrimps and little amphipods and little crabs. And in just one holdfast, for example, we find more than 30 or 40 of these different species of just crustacea alone.
And if you move to the next holdfast, you're going to find another 30 or 40 species, many of which are probably not the same.
Easily. I mean, it's still a work in progress, so we don't have the data yet, but in principle, yes, there's like easily 40, 50 little species of
just
only crustaceans.
So that's an amazing diversity, and that's just one group of animals. So if you were to then move on and look, let's say, at mollusks, you would probably find as many, if not more, species.
Probably, yeah.
The
more you look at, the more you find. And our coast in South Africa is so remote and so unique and so far away from other places as well, that almost everything that we find has always the potential to be endemic, so actually only occurs here. And rates of endemicity for the Great African Sea Forest is very, very high. It's probably 40-50% of the species that we find would probably only occur here in the world.
No, and I guess the more Holdfast we look at, the more species we're going to find. And I know some of the species that you've actually shown me the specimens of, I know are completely new to science. So these are actually never been seen before species that we're discovering. Somebody just has to name them and write them up. So as well as the Holdfast, which have all this complexity in them, you know, so I guess on the stems, the stipes of the kelps, and on the front, you also get a specialized group of animals living.
Yeah, for sure. So here we have this one, like we've just pulled one of these kelp stipes over. So this is basically the whole plant that kind of got ripped off by a big wave. And then this is obviously a habitat on its own, and maybe one of the most iconic species that lives on these stipes is the kelp limpet. And the kelp limpet has this very special shape. It's laterally compressed, so the sides are squashed together so that it fits onto the kelp stipe. And it goes up and down to clean the kelp stipe, and of course feeds on all of the things that like are growing on there, and it keeps the kelp clean. Right. And it provides an incredible benefit for this kelp plant, because underwater, when there is a surface of anything, there will be something that will be growing on it. And that is not so good for this kelp, because it would create a lot of drag in the waves and increase the risk of being ripped out and being drifted away. Mm-hmm. And of course, the kelp provides the only habitat for this limpet in return. Right, so it's right. A real mutualistic relationship that's actually happening there. So the fronds that build that canopy provide another whole surface area, for example, for the juveniles of the kelp limpet that we just saw. They are mostly on the fronds and then move down onto the stem when they get older. But there are all sorts of lace animals or bryozoans, and then there is a nudibranch that eats these bryozoans, or hydroids and all these kind of invertebrates. There's a little suckerfish, like the weed sucker, that lives in between these fronds. So there's just a lot.
Yeah. So when you look at the whole kelp plant, I mean, you've got these different subsystems. You've got a whole group of animals that live in the Holdfast. You've got another separate group of animals that live on the stipe, and yet a third group of animals that are living on the front. And then, of course, there are the predators that come in, like octopuses and fish, and feed on all those things. So there's a whole food chain.
Absolutely. And of course, the fish that are around and would eat this as well.
Yeah, yeah. So yes, I know you're creating a website about the animals in the Great African Sea Forest. So can you tell us a little bit about that?
So it's 1,001 species, and we picked that number for a reason, because it's leaning onto the 1,001 Arabian Nights, that bigger story, or actually a accumulation of all sorts of stories which a young girl told to save her own life. Mm-hmm. And in this case, we're trying to tell the stories of 1,001 species in this ecosystem, so that we are hoping that we can better protect this great African sea forest. Mm-hmm.